Why? And I'm turning to all of us. Try to work hard that we should be loved by the people from heavens. Even if the people on earth don't love you, but if the people in heavens, they love you, because of a small thing that you do to Allah, it is great. And the thing that changes the difference in what we do is our niyyah. You may have a very small thing that you do, but the niyyah will make it bigger in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you may have something very big, but because of your niyyah, you lose that amal. Take for example, a man came and said, Ya Rasulullah, if I go for jihad with the niyyah of being bravery, and you know jihad is something very big, if you die in jihad, if the niyyah is not for the sake of Allah, he says you don't get the reward. On the opposite, there's that lady who gave water to the dog. I'm sure you know the story. Gave water to a thirsty dog. This is a job which not many people want to do it. But see what happened? She enters shulga, despite all this kind of situation. So let us work always, whatever we do, our side should be our. Please accept. And if the people in the sky loves you, and the people in this dunya, they don't like you much. Okela, you say, tell them okela, it doesn't matter. So long as you're doing the right thing. And then the other second thing is the intergeneration love. See how the Prophet created the love between the generation of the Sahaba and the Tabi'in, the next generation. And that's why in the hadith that we see, he was also connecting this generation, the next generation, the generation. So many of us, unfortunately, sometimes today, when we inherit to the next generation, even in our succession plans, when another generation succeeds, what happened to the management before that? Even intergenerational management, put that in. One management to another management, or you? Everyone will take the knife. Later on, when the Prophet spoke about that, and I think this is something, we don't have that continuity of love, we don't have continuity of thing. All the time we are tearing apart, that the Prophet created that intergeneration. And last of all is companionship with our parents. In fact, I wanted to give statistics, but I didn't want to spoil our chairman with statistics. It would spoil your days. But really, statistics are also not good, although it is worse in non-Muslim countries, where the increasing number of old folks home. And then we also see our statistics in our beloved country. It's also increasing, I saw the numbers. And wallahi, I tell you, wallahi, and I swear by Allah, you want the rahmah of this dunya and akhirah, take care of your parents, particularly your mother. Well, I take care of them. You will have the best of these two worlds. One man, his mother died. Then he had a call, something recorded in his heart, a munadi, as a voice coming from the sky. And the voice telling him, he was a very pious Muslim, the voice told him, لَقَدْ مَاتَتَ الَّتِي كُنْتَ تُرْحَمْ مِنْ أَجْرِهَا. The person whom you used to get the rahmah of Allah because of her, she has died. You see? So the rahmah that we get from our parents, mother, is so great. That's why the Quran tells us, وَصَاحِبُهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. And believe me, if you take good care of your parents, you're actually being service to yourself. You know why? Because you are telling your children what a good example is. Tomorrow you come in that position wallahi, you get the barakah of what you did to your parents. And the opposite is uquq al-walidain. When they become angry with you, you will have the entire world in you, but you will never be happy. And worse still, you will see the impact on your children. The same thing you did to them, wallahi, will happen to you. To conclude, there was a brother whom I know very well. This brother traveled abroad, and he was avoiding his parents. And the parents led a very, very difficult life. And he got a very nice life in Europe, manager and all this and that. He thought everything was moving fine. Now the ordeal started, you know what it is? SubhanAllah. Allah started giving him children with all kinds of complications. Taking most of his time, which he should have offered to the parents, now all the time he's entering the hospital, doing this, doing that. He emailed me, and I just asked him one question. I said, how was your relationship with the parents? And he replied in 2 lines. He says, Ustaz, I abandoned my parents. Then I told him, use this as a test from Allah and seek forgiveness, maybe because of His rahmah. If you remember what you did and you have sabr, maybe you'll come out of this ibtilah. So sometimes we don't realize that it is also reflected in the kind of situation. But if you are good to your parents and still Allah gives you this test, that means He wants to raise your level. Because of your goodness to the parents, He gives you a test to raise your level high so that you are loved by what? The people of the heavens, not the people of the earth. So tests come in 2 ways. One, either Allah wants to raise your level, or secondly, He wants to give you a chance to repent so that He forgives you and give rahmah because of our early deeds. Okay? So that is the conclusion about the generation of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and particularly ways al-Qarni. And we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us and make us learn from the lesson of the generation of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now we open up for 10 or 15 minutes for any comments, Q&A. Because actually the tazkir is supposed to be short, not a lecture. Okay, because when this man entered the masjid, the first man, he was a very poor man. So the companions did not know what is so much about this man. What is it that great he did that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says he will enter paradise? This slave.
But he's not wise.
No, wait. He was a slave. And so they wanted to know. Then the Prophet started explaining that, you know, there are people whom they are very pure, they are this. Then they wanted more example of such people. Then he gave the example of our boys. Yes. Yeah. Exactly. That's a good question. These people exist at all times. And really there are a lot of other sifat he gives of different people. He said there are certain people also, their sifat is they just want to be helpful. Certain people, their sifat, their heart is always clean. So they have all of the sifat. So these people, they are still among us. You don't know, maybe our governors, they be among them. Our machi in the stall, when you pass, you don't know them, but why they have the secret? Yes, until today they exist. Yes.
I have a question. Because we are dealing with students, and we teach them not to take riba and whatnot.
Mm.
And then, but they told us, like, you know, well, if we don't make loan in from the bank to buy cars or houses, how can we survive and whatnot? And I told them, you just believe in Allah. How to make them become firm on that? Because otherwise, we cannot teach them simple life. Because they think that if we don't have car in the culture of Malaysia, then we are like, you know, we cannot survive and whatnot. So this kind of thing, how to make them become firm?
Exactly. So there are two ways. One which you have approached is religious, but the other one is to bring cases.
Mm.
For example, you take countries like Germany, more than 80 people, they rent houses, okay? And I also tell them that the next few generations,
yes.
This I'm telling you the truth, it's coming.
Mm.
Now, with the development of fintech, people will no longer think about owning a house. In fact, owning a car or a house, they started already.
Mm.
And I'm sure our chef is one of them now. He started renting a car.
Mm.
Because what you need is transport.
Not the things.
Exactly. Even in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it says about the basic need, it says, "Bumlatun tasud biha jawatak." وَخِرْقَةٌ تُوَارِ بِهَا سَوْأَتَكْ فَإِنْ كَانَ لَكَ كِنٌّ يَكُنُّكَ فَحَسَنٌ وَإِنْ كَانَ لَكَ دَابَةٌ تَرْكَبُهَا فَبَخٍ He says, you need food, you need clothing. And then he says, if you have a shelter, he did not say home, house, if you have a shelter to shelter you, it is good. If you have a transport, use the word transport, to use so much the better. You see, even see the word, good, better. That means it is an if. If you have, if. But for food and clothing, there's no if. Everybody must have it. But other than food and clothing, the word if comes. So in other words, the coming generation is people will begin renting. Even expensive cars now, they are going to have a fintech of renting. And in fact, to me, renting is cheaper.
Yeah.
Because all the other liabilities of insurance, blah, blah, you don't have. You rent after 2-3 months, you change another car. So my view is, you give them the alternative that as you continue to amass your assets, then you use the simple thing is, begin renting. Or use public transport.
They look at it like a low standard thing to some cultures. So we want to change the kind of thing.
This is a perception. This is a perception. I have, I'm sure many of you know that I have my wife is working in Turkey.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot afford buying a car there. When I go there, and I'm sure she also experienced that, really I go to public transport.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's very cold, you have to stand in the cold on your face. But
I enjoy it.
Because the calamity of being exposed to river and death. You can withstand the cold, but you cannot withstand the psychological trauma of death. Believe me, you have sleepless nights, and worse still, may Allah say, we don't know when we will die. Imagine you have riba and you die tomorrow. You have not only lost the house, lost the car, you have lost the entire dunya and you have lost the entire akhirah. You have lost it. So, a life of a mu'min is based on affordability, especially for the young ones. The old ones, they have already got enough assets. But the younger one who is still beginning their life, do you see statistics on bankruptcy? See the statistics on debt as a percentage of household debt, percentage of GDP. You become surprised, why do you want to live this kind of a lifestyle? Now even, marriage also, you know, can't win that. Tomorrow you want to have a child also dead. why everything has to be that? So I think we have a lot of role to play to remove this psyche of that because of the social pressure. You want to add the people of dunya, but remember, if you do the right thing, so my advice is you tell them about the impact, because many of these young boys, they don't know the consequence. Yeah, and really, and also I appeal to parents. Believe me, start with your children at home. Always don't leave them a chance. Always tell them about that. The big mistake we do at home is our stories at home is warning. Then we grieve. But if you tell your children about struggling to acquire, the story is different. They will know if we don't have, we have to struggle. But the moment the entire house is talking about, ni percentage ni, so they pick up the story. But if you're the parent, you say, inshallah, I have to work very hard, I need to buy me, I have to work very hard, I have to do this, then the children also pick that story. So I think the young people, we need to really tell them about the danger.
They don't have confidence in that, especially for Malaysian. If they don't receive any scholarship, they have to continue study using PTPT and with the interest.
Yeah.
So many times I told them, don't you have any other alternative? And they say, we come from poor families and we can't afford because in this and that. So if I don't take PTPT and they said, if I get first class, then I don't have to pay the whole thing. I said, but in the first place, you're already involved in the contract. So how to convince them basically? Because even if they're taking RKHS and whatnot, they say the same thing to us like that, although they're studying RK. So that's why I say the firm belief.
Exactly, I agree with you. That this, and this one thing is, which you tell them, if you have this knowledge, and I give in my class an example. There was a brother, many of other students here who come to study, they don't have scholarship. Even the Malaysians who don't have scholarship, but they work. So you give example of those Malaysians who work to fend for their, many of us also, our education, we are studying. We used to do our job to fend. I'm sure all of you who go abroad also, you do the same. Yeah, and I agree. So I think we need to.
I think the exposure, okay, because American, all of them work.
Exactly.
In order to pay tuition fee.
Yes.
It's just exposure.
Exactly. And when I was married also, I used to work in the library, doing it for 1 hour.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Yes, we just work. You work at that moment.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. JazakAllah khair. Assalamu alaikum.